Well, good morning. Welcome to Redeemer this morning. We hope you have just come with an attitude of gratitude this morning. We know things look different for you. We wish, as a worship team, we were looking out at some faces this morning. But I want to read Psalm 100. We were reading that this morning as a team together, and just some of the phrases really spoke to me. And hopefully they will speak to you as well as we begin. This is Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. So our prayer this morning is that you will be reminded of God's faithfulness this morning. You will enter in with a spirit of joy and of thankfulness this morning. Let's not focus on the news. Let's not focus on how we wish we were here and not at home. Let's focus on who God is and how he is faithful to us this morning. So join in with us, sing along, we hope, as we try to encourage you this morning.
Seek and you will find.
give that a try at home, and let's sing together how his promises are true to us. Father God, encourage our hearts this morning by these truths, Lord. These are truths we sing based on the Word of God. Father, encourage us by your faithfulness this morning. You never leave us nor forsake us. We are yours. Father, I pray, God, for those this morning that watch with a broken heart. They have lost hope. They are discouraged this morning. Lord, may a word in a song, may something that is said or prayed or taught to us this morning, God, encourage our hearts, bring us hope. Our hope is in you, not in anything else, Father God. So may we rest in you, rest in your promises that are true, believing you to be a faithful God. So, Father, we continue to commit this time of service before you this morning. Open our hearts that we may receive from you, God. Help us just to give this time to you and allow you to work in and through our lives, we pray. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, team, for sharing your gifts with us and leading us in worship this morning. It's a blessing to me, and I hope for you online as well. You're able to engage in worship from your homes. As we continue on in our service, I wanted to mention our ways to give through your offering. So I know we can't be in person to give, but we do appreciate the way that you partner with us so faithfully through online giving, through e-transfer, or through your debit program. We appreciate that, and we're excited to be able to look forward to different ministries we're gonna be taking part in the coming weeks and months, and we appreciate the way that you faithfully give to partner with us to support those ministries. So now I'm just gonna give a little shout out to my Firelight friends at home. I know you can't be here in person today. We are looking forward to having our in-person Firelight, but that's okay because you're able to participate online at home as well. All of your Bible lessons are posted on our website, and then there are resources for you to go over with your parents or grandparents with some questions that you can learn at home. We've been learning about what happened after Jesus rose from the dead. So in our lesson today, Jesus appeared to his disciples, but some of them didn't believe he was real. So watch that video and see what they thought. And now I'm going to turn it back over to our team.
Thank you. Well, before Pastor Carl comes and brings the Word of God to us this morning, we want to sing one more song that just reminds us of the God that we serve. There is only one God that we serve.
Thank you. Well, good morning, Redeemer. The church gathered and the church scattered all at once is what we are. And it's good to have everybody joining us online and a few of us here in the room as well. I'm just going to throw my, you know what? I'm just going to throw it over there like David Letterman. This morning we're reading from 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 11 all the way to 36. Then Elkanah went home to Ramah, and the boy was ministering to the Lord in the presence of Eli the priest. Now the sons of Eli were worthless men. They did not know the Lord. The custom of the priests with the people was that when any man offered sacrifice, the priest's servants would come while the meat was boiling with a three-pronged fork in his hand, and he would thrust it into the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot. All that the fork brought up, the priest would take for himself. This is what they did at Shiloh to all the Israelites who came there. Moreover, before the fat was burned, the priest's servant would come and say to the man who was sacrificing, "Give meat for the priest to roast, for he will not accept boiled meat from you, but only raw." And if the man said to him, "Let them burn the fat first and then take as much as you wish," he would say, "No, you must give it now, and if not, I will take it by force." Thus, the sin of the young men was very great in the sight of the Lord, for the men treated the offering of the Lord with contempt. Samuel was ministering before the Lord, a boy clothed with a linen ephod. And his mother used to make for him a little robe and take it to him each year when she went up with her husband to offer the yearly sacrifice. Then Eli would bless Elkanah and his wife and say, "May the Lord give you children by this woman for the petition she asked of the Lord." So then they would return to their home. Indeed, the Lord visited Hannah, and she conceived and bore three sons and two daughters, and the boy Samuel grew in the presence of the Lord. Now Eli was very old, and he kept hearing all that his sons were doing to all Israel, and how they lay with the women who were serving at the entrance of the tent of meeting. And he said to them, "Why do you do such things? For I hear of your evil dealings from all these people. No, my sons, it is no good report that I hear the people of the Lord spreading abroad. If someone sins against a man, God will mediate for him. But if someone sins against the Lord, who can intercede for him?" But they would not listen to the voice of their father, for it was the will of the Lord to put them to death. Now the boy Samuel continued to grow in stature and in favor with the Lord and also with man. And there came a man of God to Eli and said to him, "Thus says the Lord, did I indeed reveal myself to the house of your father when they were in Egypt, subject to the house of Pharaoh? Did I choose him out of all the tribes of Israel to be my priest, to go up to my altar, to burn incense, to wear an ephod before me? I gave to the house of your father all my offerings by fire from the people of Israel. Why then do you scorn my sacrifices and my offerings that I commanded for my dwelling, and honor your sons above me by fattening yourselves on the choicest parts of every offering of my people Israel? Therefore, the Lord, the God of Israel, declares, I promise that your house and the house of your father should go in and out before me forever. But now, the Lord declares, far be it from me, for those who honor me, I will honor, and those who despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Behold, the days are coming when I will cut off your strength and the strength of your father's house, so that there will not be an old man in your house. Then, in distress, you will look with envious eye on all the prosperity that shall be bestowed on Israel, and there shall not be an old man in your house forever. The only one of you whom I shall not cut off from my altar shall be spared to weep his eyes out, to grieve his heart. And all the descendants of your house shall die by the sword of men. And this that shall come upon your two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, shall be the sign to you. Both of them shall die on the same day. And I will raise up for myself a faithful priest who shall do according to what is in my heart and in my mind. And I will build him a sure house, and he shall go in and out before my anointed forever. And everyone who is left in your house shall come to implore him for a piece of silver or a loaf of bread, and shall say, 'Please, put me in one of the priest's places that I may eat a morsel of bread.'" It's a long passage, but if we're going to spend time doing anything, maybe spending time reading the word is a good thing. But let me begin with a bit of a story. In the year 2000, a man named Reed went on an airplane to Dallas. And he went to visit a man named John. And it wasn't a mere visit, it was meant to be a business trip. In fact, Reed was proposing to John that they merge their two businesses together. Now, at the time, Reed had a much smaller business, so he knew that he was asking the bigger business of John for something that would be a hard sell. So when they met, John understandably said, "You know what? We're not prepared to make this merger. It'll benefit you more than us. Thank you, but no thank you." And they went their separate ways. And 5 years after that meeting, John was fired. And 10 years after that meeting, his multi-billion dollar company was bankrupt, all because he turned down the merger with a smaller company. And those two people were Reed Hastings, the CEO of Netflix, and John Antioco, CEO of Blockbuster. Now, Blockbuster Video has become a great case study for people on how not to run a business that is going to adapt to the modern age. It's not entirely fair. Everybody, by all accounts, says John Antioco was actually a really good CEO, very competent. He more than doubled revenue at Blockbuster. He did good things there. The problem was that he didn't see the changes in time, and then when he finally did see them, the organization wasn't able to adapt. It physically wasn't able to. He told them, "You know, we have two big problems as a company," and I'm simplifying, but two big problems. One, $200 million of revenue comes to us every year from late fees, and it's not a good practice to build a business on penalizing your customers, especially because people like Reed Hastings were creating things that got rid of late fees. So he knew they had to get rid of late fees, but that was a $200 million blow. The second thing he said was, "We have to invest in an online platform, but that's going to cost us $200 million more." So when he went to the shareholders and the board and said, "I've got a $400 million idea, and it's going to cost us money, and I'm not sure it's going to work, but we have no other hope," the board turned him down. He was eventually fired, and we know what happened to Blockbuster shares. Now, the reason I bring, and before I go on, let me say this. A guy named Greg Sattel, writing for Forbes magazine, highlights what actually went wrong very quickly. Here's what he says. "The irony is that Blockbuster failed because its leadership had built a well-oiled operational machine. It was a very tight network that could execute with extreme efficiency, but poorly suited to let in new information. Antioco's fatal flaw wasn't one of intelligence or capability, but a failure to understand the networks that would determine his fate." See, by the time they had to change, they found that the organization was so entrenched in its ideas that it couldn't move. And I bring that up here because what we see in Israel at this point in its history is after 100, 150 years, maybe more, of the time of the judges, what we see is entrenched ideas of worship. We see ideas that had so infiltrated Israelite culture that they had become set in stone. This is how Israel was ruling, how Israel was running their worship practices at Shiloh, which was the center of cultic worship for Israel at the time. And their practices and philosophies were so ingrained that it becomes clear, in fact, this passage shows us that there was no opportunity for rehabilitation. Amputation was the only option. And that's why you have such a hard, hard passage to read. And they're similar to Blockbuster in that way, or maybe Blockbuster was similar to Israel in that way. And that's why I bring it up. But if we look carefully at this passage, we can see some things that will help us not only avoid the problems of Israel at the time, but also to master many other problems we have as well. So we're going to look at this passage quickly, and we're going to see, first we're going to look at the evidence of corruption. What was going on at the time? What was the problem? So what was the evidence of corruption? Then what are the reasons for corruption? Why did it become that way? What happened in Israel's past that made this the way it was? And then lastly, what is the cure that is offered for this corruption? So, evidence for corruption. Let's begin with what a priest is. A priest is supposed to be a mediator between God and man, and between man and God. And so, it's both a vertical and a horizontal relationship. So a priest is there to take the offerings and the petitions and the needs of the people and lift them up to God. And to do so properly, ritualistically, because if the offering isn't done properly, it will never get to God, in which case Israel is foiled. So it's a very important job, reaching the petitions of the world up to God. But he's also responsible for taking the conferring, the blessing and the communication of God down onto Israel. So when God announces a promise or atonement or a blessing of some type, it's the priest's job to confer that. And so, in fact, if you want to get an even better idea, a better image of this, look at Numbers 18. Number 18 is complicated. It outlines the duties of a priest. And two things specifically stand out. One of them, it says, the priests are accountable for worship. And if the temple is in any way defiled, the priests are the ones who will be held accountable. Because it has to be kept perfect, the temple. And the reason is, God is holy. So you can't have things being in the temple that are unholy. But also because, as I just said, if the offering is going to benefit the people, it must be done a specific way. So a lot of pressure put on the priests. And aside from that, the second thing it says in Numbers 18 is the priest is given this great gift. Priests were not allowed to have other jobs. They couldn't moonlight. So as a result, they had to make a living from the temple. So God says in Numbers 18, all the offering is mine, God says, but I'm going to give you a portion of it as a gift. And it's to be remembered forever as a gift. Yes, it'll be in the law that you're allowed to get this, but make no mistake, Levites and priests, Eli, Hophni, and Phinehas. What you get is not a right. It is a gift of grace always. So those are the two underlying things a priest is to be. So now let's look at what was actually happening. What were the sons actually doing? So in the temple, we find Eli is old. And Eli is so old that he has now conferred and handed off all of the day-to-day operations of the temple to his sons. So Eli now, you'll notice, is sitting at the gate and he's ministering, but he's not doing the grunt work of running the temple. And we learn, sadly, right away that these two sons are known as, in the Hebrew says directly, the sons of Belial, not worthless men. It says the sons of wickedness. So that's not a great start for the sons. And then we learn right away as well that they don't know God. Now, if they don't know God, what it means is they don't know who he is personally, and they don't know what he wants ritualistically, which means they don't know how to be priests. If you don't know the one you're ministering to, you don't know how to minister to him. And so that's no surprise then when you read what's going on. And here's what's happening. People would come with their offering, and it would be boiled usually in what was happening at the time. And it's notable that the writer of Samuel says that these are the customs of the priests. It doesn't say these are the customs of God or what was prescribed in the law. It says this is the customs of the priests. So right away you should be thinking, okay, well, let's scrutinize these practices. And what was happening was you'd bring your offering, it would be boiled, and a servant or a priest would plunge a fork into the boiling pot, and whatever came out, luck of the draw, the pot luck, whatever came out was the priest's. But it seems the sons of Eli didn't like this game of chance because they were getting a lot of crummy cuts of meat, maybe. So they started to go a little ahead of the game and say, before we boil it, give me the meat, and I'm going to take what's best from it first before it gets cooked. And the people, rightly, would protest and say, no, at least burn the fat off it first and then take what you want. And the priest would say, no, give it to me now or I'll take it from you by force. This is obviously not good. And when you hold it up to scripture, what you see is a few things. There's no evidence in anywhere in the Bible that priests are supposed to plunge a fork into a boiling pot and pull out stuff for themselves. So we don't know where they got it from. Is it just made up by them? Is it evidence of syncretism, which is the mixing of religions that you see so often in the book of Judges? We don't know, but either way, it's not prescribed by God. So they don't know what God asks. And then it turns out the people knew more about worshiping Yahweh than these priests did, because they're the ones who said, burn the fat. And that is in Leviticus. It says, burn the fat for God, and then the rest is to be handled differently. So what we see cumulatively, especially if you add to this the fact that they're sleeping with the women, the female servants at the temple, we're beginning to see that they have no regard for God because they're just doing what they want. They have no regard for the people because they're not getting their petitions to God rightly. And sleeping with the temple women is either a sign of abuse of power and lust, or they're adopting to Canaanite traditions of sleeping with temple prostitutes. But either way, we realize that nothing good is coming here. Nothing good is happening. And the problem is this: they're under the impression that they can worship God any way they want and God will accept it because he'll take any worship I give him. And we have to be careful that we don't just think that's a historical thing, because today we do it often in churches, and many, many groups in the Christian church do this. I've known people who've said to me, you know, I'm not going to tithe to the church because I'm going to use the money instead for this poor family I know, or I'm going to give it to this organization. Now, listen, God doesn't require your money. However, when we do that, it sounds like it's pious, but it's actually not what is prescribed. And we have to be careful to understand one very clear thing about worship, and it works in human relationships too. Worship always flows upwards, but the prescriptions on how to worship always flow down. If I have a wife, which I do, and she tells me I am allergic to daisies, if I want to have a good relationship with my wife and I'm going to buy her flowers, I will not buy her daisies. I will obey her request and give her what she wants because she tells me how to love her. I don't get to just say, you're going to take daisies and you're going to like them. I could, I suppose, but I would not be married. The point is, worship can't just happen any way you want. And the problem is, this is what's happening in Israel at the time. They're just doing whatever they please. But amidst this corruption, there is hope. All through the story of Samuel, there's hope. And I love what the writer of Samuel does. Look, because it's a pretty dark passage. It's not pleasant. But he peppers and salts in talk about Samuel and his family to show us that God is still at work, even in the midst of this corruption. Verses 11 to 12, if you read them, you know, you don't look at the breaks that your Bible puts in, because remember, in the Hebrew, it's just a big block. There's no punctuation and breaks. And if you read those two verses back to back, here's what it says. And the boy was ministering to the Lord in the presence of Eli the priest. Now the sons of Eli were worthless men. They didn't know the Lord. See the back-to-back contrast, where the writer puts good Samuel, faithful Samuel, unfaithful sons. And if you jump ahead now to verses 17 and 18, he inverts that, he switches it, and he starts with the sons and says, the sin of the young men, the Na'ar, were very great in the sight of the Lord, for the men treated the offering of the Lord with contempt. Samuel was ministering before the Lord, a boy clothed in a linen ephod being the prescribed dress for a priest. So we're shown this contrast. One family is on the decline, and one seems to be stirring. And what you're seeing, remember last week, if Hannah's faith was the first signs of faith, of hope in a future and life stirring in the womb of Israel, then Samuel is being presented as that seed slowly growing. Somehow, maybe it's like a mushroom in the darkness of Israel. And we see this growth. So there's hope there. So that's what's going on. But now let's look at the reasons for the corruption. Why? How did they get this way? Because it doesn't happen in a vacuum. And we're going to look at something that happens to the sons. The sons have an issue, and then Eli has a part to play in this as well. So first, let's start with the sons. Now this, I remember in 2018, when American Senator John McCain died in August 25th. There was, you know, it's typical. You go online and there's all kinds of people tweeting about how much they loved or hated a celebrity who dies. And a writer for the New York Times was witnessing this. He was watching his social media feed. And he started to notice a pattern in the way people were eulogizing John McCain. His name was Frank Bruni, this writer. And here's what he said in the New York Times 2 days later. Just before and after John McCain's death on Saturday, I read many tweets, Facebook posts, and essays that beautifully captured his importance. I read many that were equally concerned with the importance of their authors. Here's how much time I spent around McCain. I'm also close to his daughter, Megan. This is a compliment he once gave me. This is what I said back. I voted for him this many times. I agreed with him on these issues, but not those. It's difficult to describe how pained I am. Here's a photo of me looking mournful. Were these hymns to McCain or arias of self-congratulation? The line blurred as the focus swerved from the celebrated to the celebrator. Bruni is not a Christian as far as I know, but he recognized something in the human heart from social media. The problem is we love to draw attention away from where it belongs and put it on ourselves. Not news to a Christian. Martin Luther and many have said that our hearts are idol factories. But he notices this, and this is exactly what is going on with the sons of Eli. The reason their worship is corrupt is because they take the offering that is supposed to be showing how gracious and good God is and how much people recognize that, and said instead, no, the offering's now an opportunity for me to get something from it. So they took God off of the throne and put themselves on it. And this had become entrenched. It's not new. By the time it comes to Phinehas and Hophni, it's been happening for over a century in the book of Judges. And long before as well, but certainly in the book of Judges. But if that's the case, well, the sons, what role does Eli play? Because you cannot escape the negative portrayal of Eli in the first three chapters of the book of Samuel. He is basically presented as a bumbling father and an incompetent priest. And we can always sympathize, because there are some good parts about Eli. You know, he weeps at times. He prays well for Hannah. He blesses Hannah's family. He weeps when he hears what happens to his sons in the ark later on. But at the same time, we can't ignore the negative portrayal in the book. And specifically, he is presented as spiritually blind, and then he is presented, perhaps not cleverly, but very clearly, as going physically blind. They're happening at the same time. And so when we first meet Eli in chapter 1 is when he observes. He sees Hannah praying. But he sees her praying, but he can't discern the difference between sincere worship and drunkenness. And so we see that the eyes of the priest of all of Israel are broken. He can't, in theory, the man who's supposed to be closest to God of anyone in the whole country can't determine authentic versus drunken worship. That should be a sign to us. But then it goes on. When he hears about the issues with his sons, notice that the writer intentionally says he kept hearing about what happened. He doesn't say he sees it. Are we led to believe that Eli never noticed it? He kept hearing it, but he didn't see directly what was going on? And why does it tell us that he kept hearing? Does this mean this is the first time Eli has raised this issue with his sons? And it's only because he kept hearing it from people? I know as a pastor, if I keep hearing the same thing from people, I'm going to respond. Is that what's happening? We don't know exactly, but we do know Eli could have removed his sons from their positions, but he doesn't. So that's questionable. The next thing, and we're not going to cover it today, but in chapter 3, verse 1, we see the writer again being brilliant. Verse 1 says, visions of the Lord were rare in Israel. Visions, okay? Visions of God were rare. And the very next verse says, the eyesight of Eli was growing dim. So do you see, no one was hearing from God, well, nobody was seeing visions from God, because their spiritual leader, who's representative of the country, is blind and increasingly going blind. And then by the time he dies, he is 98 years old, and we are given the curious information of his eyes were blind. He couldn't see. So we see this progression of a man who is spiritually dumb, spiritually deaf, and blind, and he's physically going that way as well. And that's bad enough of an indictment of poor Eli, but it gets worse, because the man of God comes to him and he says, not only have you ignored the problems, but you've participated in them. Listen to what he says. Why do you scorn my sacrifices? You, he's talking to Eli, why do you scorn my sacrifices, my offerings that I commanded for my dwelling, and honor your sons above me by fattening yourselves on the choicest part of every offering of my people? So Eli is portrayed as someone who's not just ignoring the problems, but he's actually participating in the sins. He's eating of these offerings that are being ill-gotten. Eli is clearly meant to show us that he was not a good leader. And this was endemic. It was a problem. As Blockbuster was unable to move and accept new information, so the house of Eli, which is the religious center for the entire country, symbolic of it, is broken. It's not going to work. But again, we have this contrast, where amidst the failures of this family, we have this very Little House on the Prairie, almost, presentation of Elkanah's family. It's almost idyllic. Elkanah continues to bring his family to worship every year amidst all this darkness. Hannah faithfully makes a robe for little, I mean, they even describe it as a little robe for Samuel every year. The care and the faithfulness of this family is a clear contrast to Eli's family. And normally sermons end up here saying, parents, you're responsible for your children. If you don't raise them well, this is what happens. They all end up as whoring Eli's sons. That's what's going to happen. I would hold off on that comment just a little. Parenting is vital. There's no doubt about that. It is central to raising children. However, We make the similar mistake if we go too far and say parenting is everything. Parents have to realize that God is the perfect parent and his kids are a mess. So parenting is vital, but it's not everything. And this passage actually shows it. Notice that every time it talks about Samuel ministering, it says he's ministering in the face of God. Well, you would, in English, it'll say in the presence of God or before God. But the Hebrew says things like he's ministering in the panim, the face of God, literally in the presence of God. And in verse 21, a startling thing, it says that Samuel, what does it say in the English translation before I go there? English translation says, indeed, the Lord visited Hannah, second part of that verse. And the boy Samuel grew in the presence of the Lord. I don't know what comes to mind when you read that, but I'll tell you what it says literally. It says that he grew with God, like at the same time as God, simultaneously in the presence of God. So what we're seeing here is, yes, parenting is important, but what is more important is that amidst all of the voices that were pushing into Samuel's head, God was willing to sit with Samuel amidst all of that. Yes, Samuel shows resistance, but the reason he can resist is, yes, he has a good family, but God is there with him. God sits there. It never says that God sits and grew with Hophni and Phinehas, but he grows with Samuel. And yes, parenting is important, but God's grace. If God is not there, there's no hope. And so we see God preserving, shaping, planning a future for Israel in this little boy. And it's not by accident that the Hebrew writer refers to these young men of Eli and the boy Samuel. They're the exact same Hebrew word, the nahar, the young boy. So he's intentionally showing you one set of young boys is going down, one is rising. So we're seeing this transition happening here. So if that's why it's happening, what is the cure? Because, well, okay, well, in one sense, the cure is very simple. When the house is filthy, it must be swept clean. I said earlier, if gangrene has set in and there's no way to stop it, you must amputate the limb. And so that's exactly what we hear. God's going to come. Eli will watch his, ironically, he will see his children die. He can't see anything else, but he's going to see his children die. They're both going to die on the same day. There will be no senior citizens in the family ever. And they will be so diminished in their stature and their place in the worship, the worshiping life of Israel, that they won't even be able to get paid for their jobs. They'll be poor. They'll have to rely on begging. And all of this, and then he says, finally, he's going to replace Eli's house with another faithful priestly house. So, if this is the case, that when we reject God, the only possible return is amputation, then what hope is there for any human? Because we've all, I mean, Jeremiah 17, Romans 3, the Psalm 51, Psalm 54, all tell us that we are hopelessly wicked. So if that's the case, what hope is there for us? Well, the only hope is if two things happen. Well, one, really, but the second one is a bonus. The first one is, well, something has to intercede for us. When Eli says, if you sin against God, who will intercede for you? That's the problem. That's the question. Who will intercede? So we need somebody to intercede for us. That's the cure has to involve that, or it's no cure. It may give me an extra few years of life, but it won't save me ultimately, unless someone has dealt with my sin. And the other thing hopefully we get as well as a cure is not just that one-time salvation, but that somehow we'll be able to stop this cycle of sinning. Will we ever get better, or are we just going to keep being people who keep falling and being varying degrees of Samuel and Eli, Samuel, Eli? So those two things. We need forgiveness, but we also need a power to stop sinning. So this passage gives us both. First, it tells us that there will be this priest that will come, a faithful, true priest who will reign forever. Now, before we as Christians jump ahead and say this is pointing to Jesus, you can't do that yet, because the Bible says otherwise. I know we're going to get there, but first the Bible says in 1 Kings, it says that this exact phrase, this prophecy, was fulfilled with Zadok the priest. When Eli's line under Abiathar is kicked out, long story, and then Zadok becomes priest, then the writer of Kings says, now it's been fulfilled. So in one sense, that's what this is pointing to. But you and I can't stop there, because there's certain language here that talks about forever. He'll minister forever. And is it by accident he says he'll minister forever before the Messiah, the anointed? Is it accidental? Well, not for us. We look back and we see the fingerprints of the gospel here. And what, of course, is that? The idea is this, that priest who will come for us eventually will rule faithfully. And he won't just present an offering on our behalf every year, but he'll present a perfect offering for us. And then we will get the gift that's promised to the faithful priest is instead transferred and given to us. So there's forgiveness for sin that comes in this great priest. But what I find interesting is the power that comes. Because if all we get is forgiveness from sin, then all that's going to happen is, great, you're saved, but you're going to continue. You'll never master any sin in your life. You're going to be a drunkard still. You'll be an adulterer still. You're going to always be bad with money. You'll just be a sinner through and through. So is there power that comes? How do we stop sinning in that regard? And we see the power in this passage. But first, let me do one real quick thing. The Bible always speaks in a certain way when it talks about salvation. And the way it does it is it puts, and I'm going to use some grammatical words, but I'll explain them. The Bible always puts the indicative before the imperative. So what I mean is this. Before it tells you the imperative, this is what you must do, it always says the indicative. Here's who you are or what you have. So in Exodus, before you get the Ten Commandments, it says, I am the Lord your God who brought you up out of slavery in Egypt. Therefore, obey the commandments. Therefore, you shall have no other gods. See what he's done? The indicative. You are already saved, so you are to obey because you already have the promise. You don't obey to get the promise. I've saved you already. Now, out of gratitude, obey. If you jump ahead just to offer some variants, Ephesians 5:1, Paul says, be imitators of God as beloved children. See what he's done? Be imitators of God, imperative. But he's put the indicative there, as sons of God, not to become sons of God. What he's saying is, as you are sons of God, be imitators of Christ. See? Don't be imitators so that you become sons, but be imitators because you're already children of God. And when this prophet comes to Eli, do you notice the order he comes in? He first says, didn't I reveal myself to you? He's speaking as God. Didn't I reveal myself to you? Didn't I choose you out of everybody? Didn't I make you my priest before my altar and to stand in my presence? Didn't I provide for your welfare with food? So what he's doing, if you think about those four things, I revealed myself. They had a need of truth, and God revealed himself. He met the need for that. They needed for truth. They needed to belong. I called you to be for me. They had belonging meant. They had material needs that were met. They had relational needs. You are mine. Listen, anytime it says mine in the Bible, it's the same as when you use it. If somebody asks me about my kids, I say, oh, that's my Caleb, my Maya, my Levi, Isaac, I name them all, Simon, Ezra. Mine. It shows a relationship. And that's when the prophet, brilliant, this unnamed prophet, shows up. He says that, and he says, why then did you scorn the offering? See what he did? Indicative. You were already saved, Eli. I gave you everything. Why then did you not do the imperative? I didn't ask you to do these things, and then I'd save you. So what the prophet is doing is what I try to do every week, and I know I'm much like these guys, I fail. My job is to show you the beauty of God every single week. First, and say, do you see how beautiful he is? Do you see how he came to you when you didn't deserve it and continues to come to you? And out of the gratitude of that, you are then called to obey. And this is why Romans 8:16 says, the Spirit testifies with my spirit, or your spirit, that you are sons of God or children of God. See what's happening. In the sermon, in communion, in prayer, in worship, in your work, in everything, God's Spirit is hammering on you over and over saying, you're already saved. You're saved. In communion, he died for you. You don't need to die again. In the sermon, you're being told that. In the worship, you're being told that. So that you'll finally, because you know what? We don't believe it. We continually forget and we think, no, my performance is really what's going to save me. And the gospel, much like this prophet is saying, you don't need to make yourself fit for salvation. You've already received it if you're a Christian. And if you haven't fallen in love with this God, if you don't find him beautiful, make no mistake, you've made something else beautiful in your life. And you're serving it, and it'll never give you what it's promising. It'll tell you you'll be happy when you have money, and you won't be. It'll tell you that the job is everything, but then the job will fire you or downsize, and you'll wonder where that God went. If you don't find this king beautiful, you will fall into the same trap Israel falls into. But fortunately, we have this great high priest who knows everything that we have faced, and he gave everything for us. Let's trust him. Let's pray. Father, thank you for these stories. It's hard to say thank you for these hard stories of judgment on people. Sometimes I feel like I'm bad-mouthing these characters I may see one day in heaven, and I'm a little concerned that they're going to punch me in the mouth. And yet, Lord, you gave us these stories. You gave us these stories to show us who you are and how great you are, and how in the midst of all this darkness, you had a plan. You didn't forsake Israel, though Israel forsook you. And Lord, you have not forsaken Canada, even though this country has forsaken you. God, I thank you for that grace. I pray that you will come out of this morning's service being glorified by all who are watching or listening. Lord, that you would be the beautiful one, no one else, because you are the beautiful one. Father, soften our hearts to the gospel. Show us time and again. Let us never get sick of looking at the cross and dwelling on what you've done for us. Father, we thank you. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Carl. Well, we want to close this morning's service with, just some words focusing on how worthy he is, this God that Pastor Carl has spoken about, and that we would, because of his holiness, we would build our lives on him.
Worthy.
Well, pray this morning that again, through what has been sung and been spoken to you this morning, that you have grown closer in your faith this morning. And if today this is all completely new to you, we trust that you will reach out to us. One way you can do that, whether you're new or this is your church, we have the connection card online. We'd love to hear from you, especially if this was perhaps your first or one of your first Sundays with us. And our regular congregants, if you have any kind of prayer request whatsoever, please put that on the connection card, and that will be passed on to the pastors. During this time of lockdown, it's much more difficult for us to know the needs of the congregation. So please reach out to us. You can call the church and leave a message on the answering machine, and that will be picked up. We also want to remind you that this Thursday night is the second week of Faith and Work. So we had a great first time last Thursday night. So we look forward to you joining. You can completely join at any time. So the Zoom link will be sent out again this week through the RB Connect. And we look forward to you joining us for that. So we want to just encourage you again to follow the guidelines that have been laid out for us to stay at home as much as you can. We're praying that those of you that have to work from home, that would go smoothly. And for those of you that start another week coming off of school break with your kids at home, that would go smoothly. So let me just close in prayer this morning. Father God, I just want to bring those particular things before you as we close this morning. Home life can just look completely different as we go into Monday, Lord. We pray over those families, Lord, that are trying to work from home, trying to help kids learn as well, and the struggles that could bring. God, just may your presence be felt in those homes, Lord. For people that are trying to work from home, maybe this is, first time having to do that. Pray your blessing over them, and may their work be fruitful, Lord. Keep us safe, Father God. Help us to be an encouragement to our neighbors, to those around us that we perhaps run into while we're out for a walk. Protect us, Lord, and we look forward to being as a church next Sunday, God. In Jesus' name, amen. So we hope to see you here 10 o'clock next Sunday morning.